And thank you so much. Good morning. What we're doing now is turning in our Bibles to 2 Timothy. And we're going to be in chapter 4 today, looking at verse 6 down through verse 8. Some have referred to these three verses as the Apostle Paul's swan song. This is his autobiographical sketch, if you will, of how he has viewed his life, his ministry, the years that have gone by and the investments that he's made in the lives of so many people. So you're finding your way now to 2 Timothy chapter 4. We're looking at verse 6 down through verse 8. And here now we find Paul penning these thoughts for you, for me. For I am already being poured out as a drink offering, and the time of my departure has come. I have fought the good fight. I have finished the race. I have kept the faith. Henceforth, there is laid up for me the crown of righteousness, which the Lord, the righteous judge, will award to me on that day. And not only to me, but also to all who have loved his appearing. Let's look to our Lord in prayer. And Father, what we're asking now is that through a great working of the Holy Spirit, you minister points of need. All of them. You know the needs that are here, the struggles that people face, the challenges of life. Pray in particular, Father, prior service, this, and for all those who are now joining us online. If there are those that do not know Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior, that they will find that through the workings of the Holy Spirit, they're taken right over the threshold into saving faith. And for all who do know Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior, pray now that there is this extraordinary mobilization that's occurring as we find ourselves committed to multiplying followers of Jesus Christ. Committed followers. Father, you know the issues of the hour, the challenges that we face personally, on one hand, nationally, globally. Your Lord over all, there is not an inch of space on this earth that you do not own. You're sovereign and you're involved. We give you praise. So Father, these moments together are significant as we continue in our worship of you. So what we're asking once again is that you would warm these hearts, engage these minds, shape these wills. As again, our Father, we've come here to see Jesus, him only. And we're praying these things again now in Jesus' name. Amen. Look at the scene that appears on the screen in front of you. It's one of those athletic moments that stand out in my mind. So I think about the significance of, in many ways, life being not so much a sprint as it is a marathon. What you see in front of you can be described by a writer in these terms. It's 7 p.m., October 20th, 1968. There's a few thousand spectators that are remaining in the Mexico City Olympic Stadium. It's cool. It's dark. The last of the marathon runners, each exhausted, is being carried off to first aid stations. And after more than an hour earlier, Mama Valdo and of Ethiopia, who was looking as fresh as when he started the race, crossed the finish line. The winner of the 26-mile, 385-yard event. Now, as you look carefully at the stands, here's this rather lonely runner. Few people remain. Those sitting near the marathon gates suddenly hear the sound of sirens and police whistles, we're told. All eyes now turn toward the gate. As this lone figure that you are able to spot on the screen here, he enters the stadium. I've referenced him off and on through the years. His name was John Stephen Akwari. He's the last man to finish the marathon. Look carefully. He's bloodied, bandaged, grimacing as he makes his way forward. Wounded. He had jostled between runners as they were trying to make their way forward, fell, dislocated, joint in his shoulder was injured, and his knee was swelling and blood was pouring. He's grimacing as he makes his way each step along the way, because that's what it amounts to now. He's really down to a step, hobbling around the 400-meter track. Those that are left, not many, but they rise and begin to applaud him as if he were the winner. And after crossing the finish line, John Stephen Akwari slowly walks off the field. News reporters are chasing him down. A lot's going on in their minds. He had no chance of winning the medal. So someone asks him right away why he simply had not quit. And his answer goes down in Olympic history. My country did not send me 7,000 miles to start the race. They sent me 7,000 miles to finish the race. Ah, the Apostle Paul would have loved it. Because the Apostle Paul would be the first to tell you and to tell me that life is not a sprint. Life is a marathon. Ministry is not a sprint. Ministry is a marathon. Occasionally, through the years, most have forgotten this gentleman, but he does now and then get interviewed in Tanzania, where he's back home, now in his 80s, and you see the smiling man there in the picture, where his family tend the fields. They're farmers. They don't look for fame, fortune, but he will pause when questions are asked about how do you live life well, and he takes them back to that story, into that momentous moment. They sent me 7,000 miles you see, to finish the race. The Apostle Paul now is at that point in time when he's focused upon the finish line. He has demonstrated extraordinary stamina and endurance. As I think about him, my mind goes back to an interview my father had to go through where he had patented a number of medications, and news reporters were asking David Highlander, what was the success and what's the secret behind the success? And how did you get started in all of this? And my father said, each and every patent was one in which I began with the end in mind. Now, for those of us that are just beginning this marathon, for those of us in the midst of it all, and for those of us who we're reaching that point where we feel as though we're beginning to reach the entering into the final lap of it all, we need a John Stephen Akwari perspective. And that's what we're going to glean from these verses. The Apostle Paul is going to connect his past, his present, and his future all in three magnificent verses that are filled with picturesque language. And out of these verses, what I want to do with you as we connect past, present, and future is to draw out four significant aspects of this marathon that you and I are called to run. And we do it with the end in mind. The first comes out of the beginning of verse 6. We're going to put it like this, that as we connect the past, the present, and the future, you begin with me by noting the offering here to be made. The Apostle Paul puts it like this, I am already being poured out as a drink offering. And as I begin to examine that phrase intensely, what immediately seizes my attention is that the word I, for I, is placed in an emphatic position in the Greek sentence. But then he says something more that grips the attention, doesn't it? He says, for I am already. He doesn't say, it's still to come. I'm already being poured out as a drink offering. Now, Timothy is reading this, isn't he? And maybe his mind goes back to Paul's ministry, not only to the Philippians and Philippi, but eventually the letter that he wrote to the Philippians, where in chapter 2, he would say in verses 17 and 18, even if I am to be poured out as a drink offering upon the sacrificial offering of your faith, I'm glad. Rejoice with you all. Likewise, you also should be glad and rejoice with me. And you say, but Gary, it's a disconnect from me. Drink offering? What does that mean? Timothy's been steeped in the Old Testament. He knows where the Apostle Paul is drawing these extraordinary insights from. Not only from Leviticus chapter 23, but that powerful description from Numbers chapter 15, when you and I are told that the Lord spoke to Moses saying, speak to the people of Israel and say to them, when you come into the land you are to inhabit, which I'm giving you, and then describes how and what offerings they're to give. He would end in verse 10 with the words that you are to offer a drink offering. It's to be a pleasing aroma to the Lord. And what grips my attention as I was studying that over the course of these days is that this was to take place, this drink offering, when they came into the land. It's when they got to the finish line. This means then that grace has been offered. This means that God's faithfulness has been evidenced. This informs us that God's promise has been fulfilled. This is what Paul is saying. Made it. I'm there. I'm God's drink offering. And Timothy, I'm here to tell you that God's grace has been provided throughout this journey. God's faithfulness has been evidenced each and every step along the way. God's promise has been fulfilled. Timothy, I'm passing the baton. Be aware of these things. God's grace has been provided. God's faithfulness has been evidenced. God's promise has been fulfilled. Think Jesus, Timothy. Think Jesus. Now maybe you're like John Stephen Akwari right now, and you're making your way through this marathon. Maybe you've fallen, dislocated something. But you get up and you keep on keeping on. You push on. And maybe you're limping. Maybe you're struggling. Maybe you're winded. But somewhere along the way, there's going to be a question that begins to arise that begs an answer to be given. Why didn't you quit? And then a John Stephen Akwari whispers into your ears, my country didn't send me 7,000 miles to start the race. They sent me 7,000 miles to finish it. And Apostle Paul would nod his head as he ponders that response. It's good stuff. You're connecting the past, your present, your future, and maybe there were stumbles, dislocations, heartaches, broken relationships, difficulties, loss. You're connecting your past to your present, to your future, because God stands outside of time and knows your future better than you know your past. And in one major connection, you start off by pondering as Paul dips into Numbers 15 and Leviticus chapter 23. And as he alludes to himself at this point, you say, there's something in this for me. The offering. My life's to be an offering to the Lord. But then I go to the cross of Jesus Christ, where Jesus said, it is finished. And the sacrifice was secured. Out of this marathon of life, there's the offering to be made at the beginning of verse 6. For I am already, he says, not to be, but now I'm already being poured out as a drink offering. But then he introduces the second of the four aspects of this connection for you and for me. Not only the offering to be made, but second of all, the departure to be anticipated. Because now the Apostle Paul goes on to say, and the time of my departure has come. He doesn't say the time of my departure is still to come. You and I, involved in airports, we know estimated times of arrival, estimated times of departure. We're constantly checking the screens of life. It interests me that from the original language here, the word time, kairos in the Greek, carries with the idea of a crucial, decisive period of time. Now, it's almost as if what Paul is saying, yes, the clouds are hovering over me, but these are not dark clouds. These are the clouds of grace. As he goes on to say at this point that the time of my departure has come, he chooses his word wisely. Departure. And if you do a word study, what you will find is that there are at least four different examples of how that word is used in that time period in which Paul wrote. For example, you are out in the fields and you've had your oxen yoked and you've been plowing and now the day has come to an end. So what do? You unyoke the animal. That was one of the word pictures. For the Apostle Paul, who had been imprisoned at various points in his journey, the word was also used to describe one's chains being loosened. In other words, Paul, in picturesque language, is saying, was set free. He also views the departure in military terms because it was used for the releasing of the ropes of a tent. And he would speak of that in different ways in 2 Corinthians 5 and verse 1. For we know that if the tent that is our earthly home is destroyed, we have a building from God, a house made with hands, eternal in the heavens. For in this tent we groan, longing to put on our heavenly dwelling. But there's victory in the end. It was also used to describe the releasing of the ropes of a ship that was about to be set off to sea. This is where Paul is at in his thought processes. As he's nearing the finish line, he wants to end well. It's not enough to start well. You got to end well. And so he would have said to the Corinthians in his first letter in chapter 15, death is swallowed up in victory. Oh, death, where is your victory? Oh, death, where is your sting? And the sting of death is sin. The power of sin is the law. But thanks be to God who gives us the victory through our Lord Jesus Christ. And there he finds the ultimate sense of release at this point. You can feel him breathing. Richard DeHaan tells a story. I was friends with the DeHaans in Michigan. It's the story where Paul was facing his departure from his life with confidence that he was ready to meet the Lord. But there was another man by the name of Paul Richard tells us, a friend of mine, for many years, who's now home with the Lord, had that same confidence. And in a letter to me, his wife Ethel wrote, quote, "When Paul and I moved to this area, Grand Rapids area, we were given the name of a good doctor. And the first time we went to him, Paul said, Doctor, you've asked us many questions. I want to ask you just one. Are you sure you're saved? After trying to sidestep the issue, the physician admitted that he wasn't. So Paul asked, how about letting me show you from the Bible how you can be sure? And the doctor replied, well, I'm going to have to think about that. Ethel tells us we then left his office, but each time we went back, Paul talked to him about his salvation. And 2 years later, the doctor finally said, okay, Paul, show me how I can know I'll go to heaven. The last time I saw the doctor, he said, Paul is the only man who showed me that he cared about my soul. So it's no wonder that when Ethel's husband Paul died, that same doctor wrote these words on Paul's death certificate, quote, ready to go, unquote. And Paul would nod his head. I'm already being poured out as a drink offering, he said, as he steeps himself in Numbers 15 for that form of imagery. The time of my departure has come. He's not saying still to come. It's already there. It's impending, if you will. But now he inches us from verse 6 to verse 7. And leads us into this third aspect. As you and I, as we connect past, present, and future, thirdly, note with me the imagery to be personalized. And he is so rich in his ability to use imagery to communicate truths. Notice the three I haves that are found in verse 7. Can you spot them? Each of which makes a poignant statement that he wants to communicate effectively. As he starts with the first one, I have fought the good fight. And when I read that, immediately what crosses my mind is that from the original language, agonizai is the word for fought. We get agony from it. We're saying that this is one who is willing to enter into the arena of life and duke it out for God's glory. For as Teddy Roosevelt once said, it's not the critic who counts, not the man who points out how the strong man stumbled or where the doer of deeds could have done better. No, the credit belongs to the man who's actually in the arena. His face is marred by dust, sweat, blood, strives valiantly, who errs, comes up short again and again because there's no effort without error and shortcoming. Who actually does try to do the deed, who knows the great enthusiasm, the great devotion, spends himself in a worthy cause, who at the worst, if he fails, at least fails when do it daring greatly. Far better it is to dare mighty things, to win glorious triumphs, even though checked by failure, than to rank with those poor spirits who neither enjoy nor suffer much because they live in a great twilight, who knows neither victory nor defeat. I love that, don't you? General Ira Eaker, wartime chief, Army Air Force Bomber Command, Europe, given a dinner to honor him and his staff soon after their arrival in England. Chief speaker of the occasion was the mayor of the village where Eaker's headquarters were located. He proceeded to speak at considerable length on the virtues of the Americans and the debt that England owed them in the war. And he called on General Eaker then to come forward for a few words. And the general, humble, no, he was known for, cleared his throat a couple of times in embarrassment and then said this: "Until my soldiers do some fighting, I'm not going to do any talking. But when we're gone, I hope you'll be glad we came." And with that, he sat down to thunderous applause that lasted for minutes on end. You see, life is not a playground, as I've said often. Life is a battleground. But you need to be able to discern the fight. The fights of life. Because what you and I see here is that Paul is saying, "I've fought the good fight." He doesn't say, "I fought a lot of bad fights." Notice that it's a singular. "I have fought the good fight." Not a bunch of bad fights. You and I are going to be around people who pick a fight over things that really don't matter. Stay focused. Be able to understand what's the good fight. Living for Jesus. He's retrospective here. He's reflective here. He doesn't say, "I will." He says, "I have." You almost sense we've got an exhausted soldier on our hands here. "I have fought, agonized, the good fight." But now, because we're dealing with imagery, he offers us to another "I have." "I have finished the race." The race. Again, life is not a sprint. Life is a marathon. But then the writer of Hebrews in chapter 12, verses 1 and 2, would tell us where our inspiration comes from. "Therefore, since we are surrounded by so great a cloud of witnesses, let us also lay aside every weight and sin which so clings so closely, and let us run with endurance." And right now, I want to speak to that person who feels so spiritually fatigued, is hobbling, making your way around the track of life. Let's run. He doesn't say walk. Let's run with endurance the race that is set before us. But where are you going to look? Looking to Jesus, the founder and perfecter of our faith, who for the joy that was set before him endured the cross. Now I connect the word endurance with the word endured. You run with endurance because what was Christ all about? He was all about being willing to endure the cross. Despising the shame. And now he's seated at the right hand of the throne of God. And out of all that, then, you've spotted the second of the three "I haves" of that particular verse. But you're already on to the third. "I have kept the faith." The word "kept" carries with the idea to watch over, to make secure, to to protect the faith. The faith, it's that Jesus Christ has died for your sins. Jesus Christ has died for my sins. And through it all, then, what you and I are able to say is that this was a battle worth fighting. The farewell address, Congress, 1951, General MacArthur. I've just left your fighting sons in Korea. They have met all tests there, and I can report to you without reservation that they're splendid in every way. It was my constant effort to preserve them and end this savage conflict honorably, with the least loss of time and a minimum sacrifice of life, screwing bloodshed that has caused me the greatest anguish and anxiety. These gallant men will remain often in my thoughts and in my prayers, always. But this man now says, as he's nearing his finish line, I'm closing my 52 years of military service. When I joined the army, even before the turn of the century, is the fulfillment of all of my boyish hopes and dreams. The world has turned over many times since I took the oath on the plain at West Point, and the hopes and dreams have long since vanished. But I still remember the refrain of one of the most popular barrack ballads of that day, which proclaimed most proudly that, quote, old soldiers never die. They just fade away, unquote. Pausing. Then MacArthur looks out over the full room of Congress. And like the old soldier of that ballad, he said, I now close my career and just fade away. An old soldier who tried to do his duty as God gave him the light to see that duty. And there was not a dry eye in the room. You've made your way now to verse 8. And as you've connected past, present, future, and you've pondered the offering to be made and the beginning of 6 and the departure to be anticipated, the end of verse 6, and then thirdly, you and I together, what we've spotted was the imagery to be personalized in verse 7 with the 3 I haves. You're on to that fourth aspect. It's the award to be desired of verse 8. Henceforth, the apostle tells us, henceforth, there is laid up for me the crown of righteousness. He's connecting past, present, now to future. You see that word crown? Those that have the name Stephen with PH, you're getting your name from that. It has to do with the crown that was placed upon the head of an athlete who finished the race. It was the description of what was placed upon the head of a general at the end of a victorious campaign, the Stephanos. Henceforth there's laid up for me the crown of righteousness. He's not saying that by running in the race, you achieve righteousness. No. He has already taught elsewhere in his writings that when you put your faith and trust in Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior, you are declared righteous. But all of that then, once you've been declared righteous, you are equipped to run the course of righteousness. And so now he goes on to say, which the Lord, the righteous judge, will award to me on that day. And then he pauses. Because now he wants to embrace all followers of Jesus Christ with the last of these words. And not only to me, but to all who have loved his appearing. Paul, you've gone through a lot. You described it in 2 Corinthians 11 with countless beatings, often near death. 5 times I received at the hands of the Jews, 40 lashes, less one. 3 times I was beaten with rods. Once I was stoned. 3 times I was shipwrecked. The night and day I was adrift at sea. Frequent journeys in danger from rivers, danger from robbers, danger from my own people, danger from Gentiles, danger in the city, danger in the wilderness, danger at sea, danger from false brothers, in toil, hardship, and on and on. And yet, there was Jesus. And now, you go back to John Stephen Akwari. And he is limping. It's been a long marathon. Goodness knows what he's had to endure as he makes the rounds, and the people have left. Few remain. Doesn't have people to cheer him on like the one who came in first. It's all right. He didn't come to run for the crowds. He came to run for his country. Paul didn't come to run for the crowds. He came to run for his Christ. But then the interview takes place. And the words that are shared go down in history. My country did not send me 7,000 miles to start the race. They sent me 7,000 miles to finish it. People. And well. For God's glory. Let's stand together. We thank you, Father, for who you are. We thank you for the one who on the cross would be able to cry out, Tetelestai, it is finished. And through faith, when we place faith exclusively in Jesus Christ for salvation, we are declared righteous, not made righteous. Declared righteous, not found to be righteous, declared righteous. But the result is that then we're to run this race for the righteous judge, who when we cross that line will say, well done, good and faithful servant. May that be the case for each and everyone here, for those in the prior service, for those watching online, may we end well. In Jesus' name, amen.